everyone, for having me today. It's a real honor to be here. My name is Ryan Scribbins. I'm fresh out of my PhD. I did it with Dr. Garth Davies, Dr. Richard Frank, and Dr. Martin Bouchard, who I'm sure all of you met in some capacity. What I'm presenting today is the third paper of my dissertation. The title, tentatively right now, is Othering Across Time, Measuring Radical Posting Trajectories Online. This is a manuscript that we currently have ongoing. We're going to be submitting it real soon, and it's going to be with myself, Garth, and Richard. So in terms of othering online, or understanding othering across time, it's first important to understand what othering really means. And in simple terms, because I'm not going to get into literature too much today, this piece is more or less a methodological piece. How we think of othering is in-groups or out-groups, as J.M. Berger would call it. Very simply, where the in-group, they share some kind of values or interests, typically developed through some kind of interaction with like-minded people and opposing forces. And on the other side of the spectrum, you have the out-groups. Very simple idea, where these people obviously have opposing values to the in-groups, and they're competing for some kind of interest. It could be for jobs, it could be for some kind of resources. But that's how we generally think of this in-group, out-group, othering phenomenon. When we think about the radical right, it's quite simple. So right-wing extremists at the top there, lovely looking bunch, are part of the in-group. Their out-group would be non-whites, typically non-white nationalists if they wanted to call it that. So blacks, LGBTQs, Muslims, so on and so forth. What we've noticed in the literature is that this in-group, out-group dynamic helps shape the collective identity of the radical right, where these like-minded individuals come together and target their out-group and they form some kind of identity around that. We're seeing this constantly online. I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar with some of the activity going on with the far right, especially around the Trump election and at the aftermath, where we're seeing right-wing extremist subreddits and Facebook pages and so on and so forth becoming these kind of hornet's nests, or these places where like-minded individuals come together and other. We're seeing this especially present in right-wing extremist forums. These things have been around since the dawn of time. Stormfront is a perfect example of this, which I will get into it shortly. And I'm sure most of you are very familiar with online discussion forums, or internet in general, being very fast, very easy to communicate with other like-minded others, radical communications in particular. But what previous research has looked at, they've looked at this othering over time, they've looked at this othering in general, very stagnant. They've looked at this us versus them dynamic, very stagnant in online spaces. They've called them lone actor incubators, hornet's nests, echo chambers of hate, polarizing spaces. But to my surprise, nothing has ever looked, or no research has ever looked at how this othering transpires over time. They've never really looked at, in fact, okay, these are polarizing spaces. What does this othering or these polarizing spaces look like over time? I'd argue that the reason for this is because there tend to be two camps of research right now, the micro and the macro, where you have the micro looking at in-depth content analyses and case studies, where they offer rich, thick descriptions about othering and what the collective identity of the radical right looks like over time, what polarizing spaces look like, but they're not really measuring it systematically. And then on the other side, we're seeing this growing body of literature with computer scientists who are trying to measure levels of radicalization, or try to catch the next bad guy, or try to predict the next terrorist attack, develop risk indicators. But they're, in many respects, and we can talk about this later, they're overlooking very simple understandings of what othering could look like over time. They're just trying to press enter and click and catch the bad guy without really drawing back. So what we're seeing is this real disconnect. We're not really seeing the micro and macro work together. So this is the purpose of this particular study. Drawing from the theoretical understandings of the micro, which I'll get into in a second very briefly, and using the technical components that computer scientists have used to analyze big data. And again, looking at the othering across time, which has not been done. So for the current study, we looked at Stormfront Canada. My supervisor, or former supervisor, Dr. Richard Frank, who's a computer scientist as well, he collected all open source data on Stormfront. But for this presentation and for this study, I use Stormfront Canada. This study is not specific to Stormfront Canada in terms of me having an interest in Stormfront Canada. It was just having a general interest in looking at how othering looks like over time. So in this particular sample, there was over 224,000 posts made by over 7,000 users, made over 15 years. So it's quite a bit of content or information. Now, the research question that guided this particular study was, how does radical right-wing posting behavior transpire and evolve over time? But really, for this presentation, it's to provide a little more context, it's looking at how anti-Semitic, anti-Black, and anti-LGBTQ posting behavior transpires and evolves over time. And the way that we address this research question is we use a sentiment-based algorithm which adapts traditional criminal career measures and semi-parametric group-based modeling, so group-based trajectory analysis. So I'll very briefly go over how the data is captured. So we have Stormfront Canada. Richard uses his technology to look at the internet, set up virtual machines, and pull down the all the bits of information on Stormfront Canada, for example, using his web crawler. It gets binned into a database in this process for this particular study or anything that we look at around terrorism extremism. He's coined the term TEEN, or the Terrorism Extremism Network Extractor. That's in a nutshell how the information is taken down. So the next really important research decision is what are our radical topics of discussion? What are deemed radical on Stormfront Canada or on the broader forum in general? For this particular study, I thought it was important to look at Jews, Blacks, LGBTQs, adversaries of the far right. And so what I did, I'm not going to get into the nuances of this particular research decision, but we had to identify a select number of keywords that were equal across each of the three topics. So what we had was I looked online and we found these extensive lists of words that other Jews, that other LGBTQs, and other Blacks. So for each of the lists, I triangulated or merged these different lists and developed an overall list. So we had 297 words for Jews, over 1,000 words for Blacks, and over 300 words for LGBTQs. But there was a problem with this, because we wanted to see how othering transpired across time, across all three of these different topics, so we needed to have an equal number of words. Clearly there's not right now. So what we did was we looked at for the inflection point. So basically you identify the frequency with which posters use these particular words, you find the cut point, and then from there you calculate the average point of diminishing returns. So discussions for Jews, the cut point was 30 words, for Blacks was 55, and for LGBTQs was 40 words. So next what we did was we the average of 30 plus 55 plus 40 is 42 words. So then I took a random sample of 42 words from these. And that was the word. That was the word selection process for all three lists. So the next was to really, so we have the words, we have the radical words, we have an equal number of words for Jews, Blacks, and LGBTQs. The next thing was to try and measure the opinions around these radical discussions, arguably. We had to find sentiment scores. So I'm just throwing up some examples. You have the message one, message two, message three, and message four. If those messages include the certain keywords that we're interested in, we identify it in the sample. Then we use SentiStrength, which is an off-the-shelf software that's fairly well established. It comes in multiple languages and it's free for researchers to use. We ran this program through all of the keywords. So it's a keyword-based approach in which, I'm going to talk about this very briefly, but what it does is it analyzes the sentiments surrounding each of these words in the messages and assigns a polarity value. So the word Zionist, for example, after it goes through its program, would have a score of -2. Nogs would have -3, so on and so forth. How this program works, it uses a STEMI method. So here's a perfect example. So here's a message where it says, I love my Jewish, Black, and gay friends. I'm just making this up. For the word Jew, it would have a sentiment score of 3. For Blacks, 3. For gays, 3. It would overall have a sentiment score of +9. On the other hand, so that's a positive message. On the other hand, a negative message reads, I want to kill every single Jew in the entire world. Around the world, word Jew would have a negative score of 59. So you're probably thinking, because I'm a qualitative researcher myself, and I initially had problems with these computational tools, but it's half decent, especially when you're analyzing big data. What it does is it doesn't just read the message and refer back to its dictionary of words and say, okay, well, Jews always has the word 5 around it, for example. It augments for booster words, for exclamation marks. So if you type in all capital letters, it augments for that. So it's a pretty decent tool, and we can talk about it after if you want as well. But it's been used in a lot of different studies. So what happens next is the data gets sentimentized and put into a matrix. So you have author A, if the author uses the certain keyword, then they get a score for that, so on and so forth. That's, in a nutshell, how it looks. So the next important point is now, so we've identified what we think are radical topics, we measure them using sentiment analysis, then we want to identify radical posting behavior. So this is the real kicker right here. This is what we've been exploring for numbers of years now. It's called the Sierra algorithm, where we have to think of a meaningful way to chop up big data with these sentiment scores. So what we did was we have four components. I'm not going to get into the technical too much, but the first component is the average sentiment score. So say I post 100 messages, and some are positive, some are negative. The Sierra algorithm will go through, average all of my messages, convert them into percentiles, because I have to be relative to Carlos, for example, who's posting messages as well, and then convert it into a score of 10. That's the first component. The second component is the volume. So it goes through and looks at all of my messages and sees how many of my messages are negative, calculates those, puts into percentiles, and then converts it to a score of 10. The next one is the severity of negative messages. Same as the volume, but the only difference is when we're talking about really negative messages, it looks for posts with a standardized value greater than 3 standard deviations from the mean. So everything over here would be considered very negative, and those would be counted as very negative messages. And the last, the duration of negative posts. So it looks at the time from the first time that I post negative messages up until the last time, and it calculates the number of days between that. Same thing, converts into percentiles, puts it into a score out of 10. Put those all together, you have a beautiful score out of 40 points. So what these measures, with the exception of the average sentiment score is just a way for us to differentiate people who on average post really negative messages versus those who don't. All of these components align with criminal career measures. What's really interesting is they provide us a reference point at which we can gauge the level of radical engagement online. It's more of a measuring tool. And it really helps us disaggregate between chronic radical authors versus non-chronic radical authors. And if you look a little bit deeper at the communication literature, you see some overlap as well with these measures. So the volume with which people are active online can increase their chance of reaching other people. So you could argue that they might have more influence on people, or they have the opportunity to have more influence on people. The language is really powerful and really important. The severity measure accounts for really powerful or really aggressive messages. And the last one is the duration. So the time that someone spends on a particular forum, for example, could indicate some level of commitment. So that, in a nutshell, is how Sierra works. That's how we came to develop this tool. But now we wanted to look at it over time, see how radical posting behaviors change over time. One for Jews, one for Blacks, one for LGBTQs. So what I took you through are all of these steps. We have Sierra, put it all through, and you have this beautiful score out of 40. But what we did was we aggregated the sentiment score, the Sierra scores, into months. The independent variable was time, and the dependent variable was the radical score. And the starting point was the starting point with which the author posted messages, whether they're anti-Semitic, whether they're Black, whether they're anti-LGBTQ. So I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with group-based trajectory modeling. It's an interesting program. It's quite a challenge to use. But what it essentially does, it identifies clusters of patterns that share some distinct or similar pattern over time. And what this helps us do is to identify chronic radical posting behavior over time. This is a particularly interesting program. There's not a hard, fast rule in terms of how many trajectories you pick. You should be basing it off the model fit, but it is more of an arc than anything. So, for example, you can set a linear model, or you can set quadratic or cubic. But what you do is you go through an iterative process, or you should, to make sure that your BICs, your OCCs, and your 95% confidence intervals are the best fit possible. That's what we did. That's what I did. Before I get into the results, I think it's important to provide high-level descriptives about what the discussions or what othering looks like, not over time. So highlights, and this is no surprise really, and we'll discuss this after. The majority of the discourse, or the negative discourse, is targeting Jews. I mean, it's a right-wing extremist forum, you kind of expect that, and I will get into this after. The most keywords are found around Jews, the most negative posts are around Jews, and the most very negative posts are associated with Jews. On the other hand, discussions around LGBTQs seem to be the most vile, seem to be the most negative, and they seem to be transpiring over the longest period of time. If you look at the standard deviations, for anyone who's a statistics person in here, you'll notice that the standard deviation is relatively high. You could argue that the outliers account for a large proportion of the variation. I removed them, and they actually didn't have a statistical difference on these results right here. These are the radical posting trajectories. I'll discuss them in just a second. So what you have are a couple things. I'll just hit the highlights. Obviously, you have two trajectories for each, which was kind of a surprise to me. I thought there would have been more trajectories, but a two-model solution was the most stable. Most authors in the sample follow a low-level chronic posting trajectory, meaning, so the reds right here are the majority of the sample. It's over 99% in each of them. So you see people progressively becoming more negative or more radical over time. But what we notice is that most people tail off or tail out of radical posting behavior at about the midway point. You just notice if you put it in a table that most people aren't posting really radical messages over 15 years. It just doesn't happen. But what we notice, which is really interesting, is people who tail out of radical posting behavior tail out the slowest around anti-Semitic discussions again. You'll notice that the anti-Semitic discussion or trajectory doesn't have a sister group. It kind of it fluctuates a little bit, goes down, and then spikes up again, as opposed to the other two, which is interesting. The anti-LGBTQ trajectory has a group of authors who quickly become radical. Like it's explosive. I mean, I know the score here is 30 and the score here is 40, but if you even level them out, do you see a spike? And we have a small group of explosive chronic authors. The people in the greens here make up a small proportion, but they seem to cool off, or maybe they get tired after a while of posting real heinous messages. But again, most people follow a low level trajectory, which is interesting in and of itself. We haven't seen anything like this before being measured in the literature. So when we put this all together, so the objective is really to identify how radical posting behavior transpires and develops over time. For this particular presentation, we're identifying group level trajectories of patterns of radical othering on a right-wing extremist forum. And this was around anti-Semitic black LGBTQ sentiment that arguably makes up in part the collective identity of the radical right. The key findings, so looking at base level descriptives, not over time, it's pretty clear that Jews are targeted at the highest volume, but the discussions around the LGBTQs are the most vile. So you have the scope versus depth perspective. Corroborating previous research, it does look like over time people are becoming more radical around gays, blacks, LGBTQs. That could be a symptom of the topics themselves. You could argue that some people perhaps are showing their level of commitment by continuously posting messages with those particular keywords, which I will get into after. But it does look like that anti-Semitic discussions are the most stable over time. And this goes hand in hand with the Zog conspiracy. Right-wing extremists generally believe, and this is a general perspective, that it's the Jews that are putting them in this position and putting other people in position to essentially target white people. So this seems to align with the literature as well. Previous studies have shown that a lot of the sentiment is targeting Jews on these particular outlets. And anti-LGBTQ, which I found particularly interesting as well, they seem to be the most explosive group. They're the most explosive conversations and the most intensifying conversations. And I can't prove this, obviously, but if you take a look at the data back from 2001 until 2016, 2001 was about the time that the Pride movement really started to gain momentum. And some of the research that I've done with myself and Dr. Barbara Perry has shown this real resistance in Canada towards this Pride movement on part of the far-right movement. So obviously we're not measuring the online to offline, but we do see some similarities, and it is something that we should be exploring further. So limitations, I mean, there's some glaring limitations. I'm seeing some faces and people are like, oh, really, you're presenting this? We understand them. I mean, adversaries, keywords, and controls. So we could easily include more adversary groups. We can include Muslims, we can include East Indians, so on and so forth. I wanted to start very simply with the kind of traditional adversaries, blacks, LGBTQs, and Jews, and go on from there. But future work should include more adversary groups, and future work should include a larger list of keywords. It's a challenge to try and have an equal number across in a meaningful way, and we think that we've done so. If you can think of other ways, we'd be very much open to suggestions. And we could also have a control group as well. You could take a random sample of authors from another sub-forum, look at their trajectories, and see if there's something distinct about Stormfront Canada, for example. We're only limited to one sub-forum, so really we're only tracking the trajectories of people in that particular forum. They could be radical in Stormfront Canada, but they could be extremely radical in Stormfront Ladies, for example. That's not something we explore, but it is something to explore in the future. Long versus short-term activities. So what we're measuring here are long-term trajectory patterns. I wanted to look at short-term trajectory patterns, but it was going to get a little bit too complicated for the dissertation. But I think that it's something to look at in the future. Instead of using the IV as months, you could look at weeks or days and see how those patterns change over time as well. And just as an aside, I mean, there seems to be a growing body of at least researchers wanting to do this. We haven't really seen anything published yet around looking at key events, seeing how the sentiment transpires around key events and see if key events do actually have an impact on online activity. Sentiment analysis. So as a qualitative researcher, it was a challenge for me at times to gauge how I felt about it. I think it's a half decent program. It's not perfect by any means. But the keywords themselves on a right-wing extremist forum are assumed to be radical. So I think that moving ahead, we should probably look at word frequencies. I think that would give us a better sense. I mean, it's not perfect by any means. But sentiment analysis, for example, there's been cases where it measures a message as positive, when in fact, you do a qualitative analysis on it, which I did for one of my studies in my dissertation, it's not positive at all. So moving ahead, we should think of more meaningful ways to use sentiment analysis, or not at all. Social network analysis of radical posters. The reason I bring this up is a really important point, which I'm sure a lot of you have thought of. Well, what about users who are not using these specific keywords? There's a lot of people who are responding to people who are discussing blacks with the word blacks, but they're not included in the sample. Well, social network analysis could help us gauge the sample of users who are perhaps in a network of one of the most prolific posters, for example. And unpacking the collective identity of the radical right. So in this particular study, I treat this collective identity as a single entity based on othering, when in fact, it is a little bit broader than that, obviously. So moving ahead, we should think of other ways to measure the collective identity, if that's what we want to do. And it can be around discussions of white power heroes, folklores, groups, so on and so forth. So just a couple of policy implications. So we can't take away from the fact that there are problems with studying online data, but they are rich with information. We can't treat them as a single entity or something that happens online and not offline. But it does give us information about how movements connect with each other, why they're connecting, how they're connecting, their identities, so on and so forth. So I think that it is important that we do study the online component of these movements. Use of computerized tools. So it is helpful in us trying to overcome this big data challenge or identify needle in a haystack. But as someone who's a critical social scientist, I have problems with a lot of these studies who don't understand the web form, for example, that they're studying, and all of a sudden they're trying to catch the bad guy. So I think that it's important for us as researchers to understand the online spaces that before we start analyzing them. So Stormfront, for example, as opposed to Reddits. So Reddits, you'll have a lot more heinous language than you would on Stormfront. So if you understand the differences in these two, it can help us on a large scale to try and understand or analyze or identify users of interest or trends of interest. So it's important to know what you're studying before you study it. Bridging the sciences is a really important piece. I just stumbled across this work, being able to work with Dr. Richard Frank. He's a computer scientist, I'm a social scientist. Bringing these different perspectives together helps us address these complicated issues. And we really need to be drawing from each other's strengths. Oftentimes, computer scientists have a high-level perspective or can use advanced methodological tools to analyze data, but they sometimes don't understand what they're analyzing. And on the other hand, social scientists perhaps know what they're studying or analyzing, but they don't have the technical skills to be able to manage the big data. So I think a key takeaway is for these different disciplines to be working together. Thank you.